I think we are live, yeah.
Okay, great. So were you going to go first or should I just? Yes. So welcome everyone. We have Mr. Gaurav Sen with us. To give a quick introduction about Gaurav Sen, he's the founder of Interview Ready, a platform which helps you prepare for system design and software engineering. And I think he has helped a lot of people get their jobs, get into this field. Prior to this interview, I think he has worked at Uber, DirectAI, Morgan Stanley, and many companies like these. In his college days, he has been a very active computer programmer and has a YouTube channel. Has a YouTube channel on system design, which has around 300K subscribers. I don't know if that's the updated stats.
Yeah, 320. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, 320. So yeah, welcome. Anything I missed, Gaurav?
No. This is great, guys. I'm a software engineer at heart. I think I graduated like 6 years ago, and this is what I like doing. I like to talk about system design, computer programming, and today we are going to be talking about practical system design, that is like for hackathons.
Oh, okay, wow. Before starting, like from a newbie's perspective, I'm a fourth year guy. I'm just getting into this industry and working at companies. So, from your perspective, why a newbie or maybe a college person doing this a degree in second year, third year, fourth year should care about system design, while he's just learning to create system simple designs, like he's not doing anything scalable or anything like that. But why should he even care about these things at this stage?
Because it's something that I and a lot of other engineers face. The first thing that we face when we go to any product based or a large scale organization is system design. So that's a very good question, Jay. And I completely understand where you're coming from. After all, the testing that is being done for getting into companies is all aptitude or algorithms or data structures. Then how does system design fit into this? Well, when you join an organization, the first thing that happens is that you are asked to write code. So like the first thing that is asked actually are other things. You probably get your laptop and stuff. But the first serious thing that you end up doing is writing code. So the way you write code is important. That is code readability, cleanliness, and that stuff.
Yes,
so
yes.
That's software engineering. The other thing that you have to do is also keep in mind all the things which are interacting with your code. Like, why is the code actually doing what it is? So some people call this the business angle of things, but there is the business angle of things, but there's also the reality is there's a lot of engineering systems that your code is interacting with. And so, like you said, it's not that you need to make your system scalable, but the system is scalable. There is a reason why it is scalable. They have used internally load balancers or message queues or whatever be the case to make it as robust and scalable as possible. And we as engineers, whenever we are interacting with it, need to know how it is working internally. If I can take a very quick example, that would be like us using arrays.sort in Java. But we also need to know that maybe in certain cases counting sort is faster.
Right.
That would help. So that would be like a rough analogy of why we need to know system design as software engineers.
Yeah, right. While you were saying about the scalability and all those things, you mentioned scalability. Like, how do you define scalability at the core?
So scalability at the core for me would be many things. So there's one thing in which you make the machine scalable. So you have a product and you want 10x more users, so you put in 10x more machines. That's one way of thinking. The other one is that people come and say, can you add this feature? Can you do this?
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little about more how do you make a code or the design extensible. One very interesting thing that a lot of people don't consider in system design is that you also have to make your system fault tolerant. So if a computer crashes, a lot of people in college, guys who are listening, you know, let's say that you have one computer on which your algorithm is running, image processing, right. Everyone is very happy. But eventually what happens is so many people come to you, they're ready to pay you money that you say, no, let me buy another computer and do the same algorithm there also.
Right. Yeah.
The smart thing over here would be like when you buy 10 or 15 computers, how do you direct a request to one of the computers is a question. What if one of the computers crashes? Can you buy a new computer immediately? Not really. So can you rent computers quickly? Can you go on Amazon and do it? These are the things that it would be nice for us to know. Honestly, Jay, a lot of the problems have been taken care of by cloud solution providers like Amazon or GCP or Azure. But it's good to know about deep down because you end up doing stuff like this very often.
Yeah, I mean, like just like you said, like if you're doing the same processing on this system, but now you have to do 10 more times the processing, there are two options you can do. You can either build a higher, bigger, better system, or you can rent out 10 more similar systems and do processing on them. This is where different type of scaling comes in, right? Horizontal and vertical. So I think vertical is when you build a bigger, higher, better performance system, and vertical is when you build.
Yeah. Horizontal would be when you buy more computers and you send requests to different computers. Vertical would be you buying a bigger computer instead of the one that you have. Or the thing that you know we should do as engineers is make our code more efficient. So for the same computer, you can get more requests. But yeah, if you have money, then why not go for?
Yeah, I recently read like the computers have been getting faster and faster, but the software is getting bloated and bloated. So modern solutions require modern problems. So yeah, that's the first thing one can do is write optimal code. And yeah, I mean, most of the times I'll write a solution which works, and then I'll ship it. And then if problem comes, then I'll see, okay, yeah, let's see if we can optimize this, or you can just rent out a bigger system or something like that.
That's not a bad idea. Making things work, as long as your test cases are running through efficiency, yeah, it can. We can look into it later on. The most important thing is readability of code and correctness of code, honestly.
Right. How do you think like someone participating in a hackathon where it's like 36 hours and you can barely even complete the solution should even care about your architecture or your scalability? I think that must hold some importance to the judges, because if you can do that within 36 hours, then it's just beautiful. I mean, you would have to think about that from the start if you want to, because inserting that scalability thing in between like the last moment isn't a thing. Like, I don't think that can
be done. No, that's one point that I've that's a very good point you brought up. I've seen in hackathons especially, there is a tendency to focus on one thing, and that is the coding part of things.
Right.
A lot of people, they don't spend too much time testing, which is actually crazy, because you're underselling yourself. All the things that you made, when they're not tested and they don't work, it looks like nahi hua. Presentation ke time pe, if you are not sure who's going to run what, or if you have a bug, then it's really something special when you see a person has a bug, looks at it, has logs which show clearly where the bug is, and then they you know solve it in real time. And ideally, it should not come up, right? You have written tests. So a small product which aims small but works is much, much more, you know, it's far more impressive than a lot of promises and nothing to show for, because you can't show code. You can't tell ki ye class file likho. Lag raha hai na achha hai. Aur bahut hi ajeeb cheez hai ki a lot of people focus on coding a lot because they have an idea and they kind of get hijacked with the fact that they have this idea. What we need to focus on is A, figure out what do the organizers want, or what is the real problem. That's basically what we need to do. Right. Then we need to try to code out part of the solution, but schedule your day. 36 hours hai na aapke paas. Aap ek kaam karo. Aap 4 ghante sirf testing pe lagao. Ya 8 ghante testing pe lagao. Ye aap seekhoge jitne aap hackathons karoge. लेकिन आप ऐसा मत करो कि लास्ट के एक घंटे में प्रेजेंटेशन भी साइड में एक बंदा बना रहा है, एक बंदा टेस्टिंग किया रहा है और कुछ भी नहीं चल रहा है और फिर बाकी दो लोग कोड फिक्स कर रहे हैं, तो उससे आप जितना अच्छा आपने मेहनत किया है वो दिखता नहीं है फिर, राइट? सो या आई मूव इनटू हिंदी व्हिच इज माय
एंड आई डोंट थिंक अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल विल हैव प्रॉब्लम बट या इफ दे डू वरत लेट अस नो yeah you brought up like test I think test driven development is a very good thing which not a lot of people follow and I recently learned about this while I was in my internship like okay like, we need to write test first and then we'll write the code which will solve those like run on those tests right that's
Absolutely,
a good thing
yeah. you can do test driven development if you haven't ever done it in your life then maybe the hackathon is not the place to start because problem is like you need to be like accustomed a bit just like in a hackathon If you pick up a different language, I find it really hard picking up a right because you know anything can go wrong and you just have 36 hours to show that. So use the tools that you're comfortable with, use the practices you're comfortable with, but do look into test-driven development. And more than anything, you know, I'm not asking you to show me a suite of tests like 15 tests jo sab chal gaye. But if you do it, it's awesome. On the other hand, I just don't want to see bugs. when you're showing the demo right there's koi bhi product wale ke paas jao product manager ke paas jab jate to agar usko bola ki hamara test coverage itna hai doesn't matter dikha de ki ye chal raha hai kyunki wo customer hai to
right
aur jaise google to main bolega 99.99% test cases covered hai to tumhe kya fark pad raha hai google search karna hai mujhe to yeah that's the thing
yeah Hackathons mein mostly hota hai, like it happens ki you write some piece of code, it runs, right? You add some other piece, then it starts failing. That's why I think I started learning at this, like I think test-driven development is a good thing if you can learn it before the hackathon and implement it. Because doing manual test case, like testing again and again on things like APIs or maybe your login form or something like that, like, yeah.
Yeah. No, absolutely. Absolutely. I agree with you.
Oh, yeah. So,
Jay, do you want me to present a part of this presentation, which has taken me about 10 minutes to make?
Definitely. I think we can.
Should we wait for more people to join? Is it that or something else?
No, I think enough people must have joined. Varad, you can maybe... give some clues in the chat. I think you can start. I can bring up some more questions through the slide. Yeah.
Sure.
Because
I'd love to take them.
Because I'm out of my questions. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was actually a little unaware. I was thinking that are people like waiting on the chat right now? So that I was going to start feeling guilty. But okay.
No, man. Yeah. You can start definitely. Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks, Jay. Thank you for the questions. They are quite interesting. And I think most of the people who are watching this, it's very relevant also, these questions. Okay, so today what we are going to do is we are going to figure out the practical aspects of system design, especially for hackathons. So like you can see, less theory, more engineering. All of the advice is actionable. It's tested. It's worked in the real world. And it's practical. You can actually apply it. Okay, so who am I? I've created Interview Ready and my YouTube channel, this is more outdated than I said. It's like 306 subscribers, actually I have 320 now. recently there was this LinkedIn top voice recognition that I got. So that's like 100K subscribers. Yeah, but I'm super happy with the social media stuff that's happening right now. It's interesting. Okay, so with the presentation, the first thing that you are probably going to face in this hackathon is choosing a database. A lot of people say that, should we go for NoSQL? Should we go for RDBMS? Should we just use a file system to store all the data that we need? File system is rare, actually. But if you're going to choose a NoSQL database, which is most likely going to be the case for a hackathon, then know about the good and the bad. The good is that you don't need to worry about the schema too much. If there is a change in schema, there are no null fields. The other entries are all there. So By the way, guys, NoSQL, when I say NoSQL, I mean that there's a key value database that you're using. So ID and the entire value.
Yeah.
The benefit of this is that usually you don't have your data spread across in multiple tables. That's one good benefit. You have usually all of it dumped into one single table in a NoSQL database. They tend to have slightly faster read and write performances, but I highly doubt you'll need scale in this hackathon. So keep that aside. Comfort is high because it has no schema, like I said. But there are certain benefits of RDBMS. One of the things is usually it's cheaper. In a hackathon, you will find places where you'll get NoSQL databases for free. You know, that much storage anybody can give you. But yeah, whenever you're choosing a database, the important thing is look at the APIs of the database instead of looking at the internals. So if you have a database which is giving you get and set methods, that's like a key value database for you. You don't care what's happening internally. You don't care whether it's a hash map inside. You don't care if there's a graph inside. For a hackathon, you're more concerned about how do you use this database. And the usage comes not from looking at the internals, but the APIs that it provides.
Right.
Okay. So how you can interact with the database is more important to you than the internals.
I mean, if someone would ask me why did I choose open NoSQL instead of SQL, I would say that our data, like in a hackathon, you probably will change your data representation or data values a lot of times. That might happen, and NoSQL very easily can accommodate that. And yeah, it's good for fast changing data represent places where data is changing very quickly. Yeah.
Correct. Yeah, the places where you are not sure whether this field is actually useful or not, you can immediately start coding. There are certain other benefits of NoSQL, which are, again, not so relevant. You know, it provides you a distributed database. You have, like, the database, if it runs on one computer, and what if the computer crashes? That's one problem. A lot of RDBMS also gives you that. But, yeah, anyway, like we said, like Jay said, rather, it's a little easier for most hackathons. And we are concerned with the API it is providing us, which is easy, versus the internals of the database right now. Okay. The second thing is, don't put in too many integrity checks. What is this? Foreign keys. If this person exists, then the department also has to exist. Or this person is a friend of this person, therefore both of them have to be from the same country. Do that on code if you like. But really, when you do integrity checks in the database, problem is, it's very hard to test your code. Because firstly, you have to check. Whenever you're inserting into the database, you have to check whether these things are true or not. So putting in dummy data is a bit more complicated. And yeah, later on, your integrity checks change. Your requirements, you know, may not be very clear initially, especially in hackathons, requirements are almost never clear. So yeah. Don't put in hard constraints initially. You want to put them in the code. And I've seen many people, some judges, I'm not like them. They say, ki ye field mein tumne number kaise dal diya? Isme to sirf letters hona chahiye tha. String. Yeah. It should have been a string. It can't be an integer. I hope none of the judges is going to test that. We all know you can do it. The important thing is that your code is working and doing what you're expecting it to. All sorts of validations and sanity checks should be kept at home, should be kept for later. Similarly, if a judge asks you the nitty-gritties of how did this work, you need to know how to make it work, but you don't need to show everything in the hackathon. We are not asking you to build Facebook or build Google. We are asking you to just, get the simple things working. That's a general idea.
Yeah. I think we have a question from the chat from Kavyansh. Why don't we store files like images or videos in NoSQL database?
Okay. So Kavyansh, if you try to store images or videos in a NoSQL database, firstly, let's say you found the right data type. In NoSQL, it's a really bad idea, honestly, because what's going to happen, you have this JSON document that you're storing. If it's a key value, in the value, you'll have a JSON document. And over there, if you store the whole image in terms of binary blob, let's say, it's going to take a lot of space. Every time you ask, what is Gaurav's last name? Uska image bhi load ho jayega database mein, ke through. So, bahut zyada unnecessary transmission cost hoga, data cost hoga. Uski zarurat nahi hai. To uski jagah tum sirf image ya video ka, you just store the URL. And that URL points to a file which is stored in a distributed file system.
Yeah, or in S3 or something like that. Yeah.
Exactly. S3 is extremely popular. I think 99% of you guys will be using S3 or some people use HDFS. These are used by companies. Yeah. A distributed file system is a good idea. Just keep the URL in the file, in the database. And anyways, it's never going to be like join all the people, like take an inner join of people who have ID this, department this, and image URL, image ka binary this. Right? You're also not going to be making updates on the image. So all of the useful things that a database gives you are not going to be used, 99% of them.
Yeah, I mean, it might have effect on like efficiency in some way, because you're processing a large amount of data every time, because text can, like data of a single person can be in KBs, but an image combined with an image or video, it can go above MBs or 100 of MBs.
Absolutely, yeah. So every time you're trying to find, like, let's say 10 people, so then you suddenly have 10 MB of data. So it's a bit of overkill. Therefore, we don't store them also together. Also, there's a lot of things that you can do with images. You can try to compress them. You can do lots of stuff. So keep them all in URLs, and you can then process them separately. While this stuff is your business logic, the data. So you want it to be as fast as possible.
Oh yeah, we can just change the image on the blob. On the S3 and have the same URL. It won't need any update on the database. That will be cool. Yeah.
Yep. That's another interesting idea. Taking locks and all that again is a problem. Security. Some people say a database provides you more security. File systems can also provide you security if you have the proper access list and stuff like that configured. Okay. Kavyan, yeah. I hope we have answered your question.
Yeah. Now
let's go for final thing. I was saying that scale. So it's very rare in a hackathon that you will need to build for scale unless you are having a lot of dummy data itself. For example, if you are building a verification system for Aadhaar, or I don't know, if you're taking like a billion users, right? There you need to say immediately that the first step, scale is very important for me. But 99% of the time, if you're selling to businesses or customers, you don't need to worry about scale too much. So choose all the solutions which are cheap, well-documented, and easy to integrate. Okay, you don't need to go for anything which is complex and can handle a lot more users. Anyway, those two things are not necessarily correlated. If a thing is complex, it's not necessarily that it's going to be able to take more scale also. These are the three things to remember when you are thinking about a database.
One more question before we move forward.
Yeah, I'll just finish this point. Let's take the question after that.
So
one thing is that you want to focus on APIs instead of the internals. Avoid integrity constraints or anything which constrains you from moving quickly in a hackathon. And scaling, keep it away. So people who are teaching you system design are now saying scale ko bhul jao in a hackathon, which is perfectly fine. Yeah. I'm sorry, Jay, you were saying.
That makes sense, because you have only a fixed amount of hours. You can do only a fixed amount of things. Yeah.
What is views on IPFS for storage? I actually don't know what is IPFS. What is it?
Aman, can you expand on that? Maybe, yeah.
IPFS, let me search it on Google. Interplanetary file system is a protocol. It's a distributed file system. Okay. No, I don't have any views because I'm not aware of this, but it seems like a distributed file system to me. And I think there is something related to blockchain in this. Yeah, well, you can look into this. My sincere recommendation to you guys would be that, know the theory, but don't go for things which are too fancy. Don't try to fit your solution to a problem. Actually look at your problem and then try to find a solution. So IPFS, it may be absolutely necessary in your use case, but something which is blockchain plus distributed file system, I don't know. Yeah, if you need it, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, if the solution revolves the whole around the idea of blockchain, then maybe, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm sure that blockchain does provide some benefits. Like, for example, maybe, I don't know, is it authentication? Is it cryptography that you're looking for when you are storing it on a blockchain thing? But I have to read up more on it. So yeah. Aman, you might be onto something here. Okay.
Yeah.
So are there any other questions or should we head to the next part?
I think we should head to the next part. Yeah.
Awesome. So here's a story. This is long back when there was I don't know if a lot of you know about this. There's something called an IPO, called an initial public offering. What happens in that is, let's say Interview Ready is currently doing business. And later on, I say that I want more money. So I go to investors. I go to angel investors. I go to VCs. I then take all the step, investors and investors. Then finally, I say, "Aur mujhe koi paise de nahi raha hai." Main public ke paas jata hun. Aur ab main public se paisa lunga. Aur wo log mera shares khareed sakte hain. So if I have, if I want to make 1,000 shares and my valuation is 1 million, then every share is 1,000 rupees. Okay, so 10 is to power 6 by 10 is to power 3. But how can I decide that? Because I will say my valuation is 1 billion or 100 billion, right? So you need a third party organization, which is supposed to be non-biased. They will come to my house, they'll check all my assets, and they'll say inka valuation is X. And then the number of shares, ka valuation is, if you have 1,000 shares, then X by 1,000 is the price of every share. Now, this is what happened. There was a company which was doing an IPO, and initially when they went public, the share prices were going okay. Everything was fine, but it is a little less than this dotted line. So the dotted line basically is the valuation that the third party has told. Kitna valuation hona chahiye.
Okay.
So if they say 40 rupees, wo dotted line wo hai, aur main market mein gaya 37 ke saath. तो अभी 37 के बाद 40 हिट नहीं हो रहा है क्योंकि लोग मानते नहीं कि ये 40 रुपीस का वैल्यू है इसका 38 39 पे रुक जाता है तो द कंपनी व्हिच डिड दिस द वैल्यूएशन इज नाउ रॉन्ग राइट सो दे फील बैड दे गो लाइक लिसन वी ट्रस्ट यू आर एटलीस्ट वर्थ 40 सो वी विल बाय योर शेयर्स जस्ट टू प्रूव इट राइट एंड या बिकॉज द मार्केट इज सेइंग 38 का वैल्यू है वी बिलीव इट इज 40 वी आर गोना बाय योर शेयर्स एंड देन लेटर सेल फॉर हायर वैल्यूज So they started buying shares. And this is what happened. Like it shot up. It shot way above the expected price of 40.
Okay. Uh-huh.
And then the company started selling shares because they realized there's something wrong. And then there was a collapse. The market also started selling with them. Everyone got scared. Like this share can't be trusted. So people started selling. Even the initial people who had the shares, they also started selling in the market. And finally, you come to this point where there is a flat line, like now it has stabilized. So at this point, you're seeing there's a problem. The problem actually is not the blue bit. The blue bit is fine. That is expected. If you screw up, there's going to be a crash. The problem is the red bit. So does anyone of you, like, can you guess what happened here in the portion of red?
Yeah, let us know in the chat. Is this a recent phenomena or is this an old story? Yeah.
This is about, I think, 5 years ago. Yeah. Or maybe even more. 5 or 6 years ago. I think 6. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. This was done by an investment bank and a lot of people got fired because of it. But yeah.
Yeah. I think every 5 years, something big is happening. 28, 29 happened. This is 2015. Then 2028.
Yeah, really. There's something or the other which keeps happening, especially in the financial world where small mistakes can be pretty big. But okay, let's see. So the problem was that the red bit.
Aman Kumar says pump and dump. Is this, like, I don't know what this means.
This is a good guess. It means that a lot of people, they say that the share value is going up. So I come out, this is completely illegal, by the way. I can come out and say, the share price is 45. It's not 40. Guys, let's buy. And I buy a lot of shares, okay? So that pushes the market up. Everyone starts believing me and they start buying. So there's a rage and you go up. Then suddenly I sell because I'm a cheat. So and once I've sold, everyone's share price crashes. And basically I made a profit in that red region, right? From 37, I sold at 45. I made a big profit. That's not what happened actually. Ayush Meher, I don't answer such questions.
there will be no naming done on this stream.
No. I'm just joking, Ayush. You can. It's but yeah. Okay. So I'll tell you guys what happened. It's similar to pump and dump, though. Basically, what happened is the company which was doing the IPO started buying shares, and they had a bug in their code, which there's a TCP has, you know, you send a request, there's an acknowledgement, and then you send data. Right. Over here, they sent a request to buy shares, and there was no acknowledgement which came from the stock exchange. So these guys had a retry logic, and they retried 50 times.
Mm-hmm.
That's the reason why the share price absolutely skyrocketed. It was much more sharp than the graph I'm showing you guys right now. And a lot of people looking at that, they felt like, okay, you know, there was a promise that it's going to be 40. Of course, it's crossed 40 and people started buying like crazy. Then when they started selling, everything else was fine. But the problem was basically a TCP testing issue. Okay. So, oh, wow. Yeah, the thing is the postmortem, like there was a lot of documentation after this, like why did this mess happen? So yeah. The engineers came up with lots of reasons. One was that in the last mile before you buy something, there should be checks whether similar transactions have already happened. There should be alerts if there is erratic behavior. Exponential back off is another idea. Like, why did you try 50 times? You should have tried only 5 times.
Oh, yeah. But yeah.
The important thing, like, even though you can say rate limiting karna chahiye, idempotency hona chahiye tha, poor documentation tha external service ke saath. Like, someone should have told us that retrying is bad here. But at the end of the day, testing was the actual issue. Should have tested it. Should have tested or should have at least clarified assumptions here, you know, but that was not done sufficiently. And so, unfortunately, a lot of people were asked to leave. Yeah.
So just let me get the story straight. Just can go back to the graph.
Yeah.
Yeah. So basically, people started buying, but the buying application was trying to connect with the main server, which was controlling this. And they were They were supposed to get like an acknowledgement to say like, okay, you bought the share, but they didn't got that. So they hit the same request 50 times. And because the server then got like 50 into how many people were doing this.
You're right, Jay. For example, I see the share price is 38 rupees. Right. I say buy 100,000 shares. So the share price now actually has become 38 rupees. Right. I won't be able to buy it at 37 now. Because the price of the share has gone up. Yep. People are now refusing to sell at a low price.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So that happens. Then I say, no, buy me more shares because I did not get an acknowledgement. So I say, buy 100,000 more.
Oh.
And so the share price is continuously increasing on the stock exchange because people are buying it at a high price. And who are the people? People like me. Mm-hmm. Not people like me. Basically, the company buys a lot. And then lots of other people come. And they say that, okay, you know, the share price has gone up. So after that, the leap that you're seeing is happening from people. The 50 requests were sent within a span of 1 or 2 seconds, most likely.
Okay.
Everything else is by the time you do the postmortem that, oh no, there's been a huge mistake. What do we do now? Should we sell? All that is happening in the red region, but the first 10% of the red region is where the mistake has already happened.
Okay, so basically the system got tricked into believing that the demand of the stock is getting high, but this was just because 50 times requests were coming in.
Correct. And the public also.
Yeah,
the public saw that stock price has gone up, let's buy. It's like IRCTC, but in a much more, without people truly believing in the stock, they're just buying it because just like that.
Yeah. Similar thing happened in this year too. Yeah.
Yeah. So, Apart from this war story, there is also the thing that testing actually saves you a lot of time. You won't need to run for the same scenarios every time you change your code. The problem with manual testing is you have to sit down and look at whether everything else is working again and again and again. You write a test, you know at least the code is running, so you're safe. Okay, manual effort, yeah, it is like point number one. You can add it to that. It builds confidence. I can't explain how confident you feel after you've written tests, because mathematically your code is telling you that it is impossible for it to fail now. Okay, right. That's a big confidence boost. Your presentation skills will go up by 100x.
I mean, those.
If you are confident about your product. Yeah, exactly. Absolutely.
I mean, those green ticks are the best. Either the code chef one or the test runs. Both are the best.
Absolutely. And code chef also, you know, it runs tests. That's the time when you feel confident. Otherwise you don't know, right? The scope of bugs also reduce in case you have missed out on some places for the test. At least you know that the mistake can only be here. Finally, you have your expectations being documented. I find it useful. But personally, I haven't found it too useful. So the top three use cases are this. It builds your confidence, saves your time, and saves your effort.
Okay. Yeah, I was building a authentication library, and I can feel like the pain of typing in my username again and again and testing if it's working right now. The auth, yeah.
Yeah, that's true. It's best to write some tests then. Yeah.
TBD,
huh? Is same thing going to happen to cryptocurrencies, Ablik Jain? I don't know what you mean by that. No, I don't think so.
I think he meant the up and down graph, yeah, similar to that.
You don't have a stock exchange for cryptocurrency anyway, so there's that benefit. And you can buy cryptocurrency using money, but yeah, that's a separate question maybe. Okay, let's move to point three, which is observability. Okay, now this is very important, guys. This is actually going to affect you in your hackathon. The first thing is logging. A lot of people don't do much logging, and some people do too much of it. So I'll try to like balance this, okay? First one is, you need to log pessimistically. If you think that this thing is unlikely to happen, still, just log it. Just log. If you think there might be there's no chance that there's an error going to come here, or sometimes this kind of information is useful, log it. The second thing is that logging is not a substitute for testing. Okay, so on one hand, I'm saying log as much as possible, log pessimistically. On the other hand, I'm telling you that please test your code. So once you have tested your code, you're not going to write unnecessary logging statements. A lot of people, what they think is that, okay, if it crashes on this line, then it should be over here. Otherwise, on the next line, there's another logging statement. Or every three lines, like, it's not making sense. You have to write a test over there anyways. And once you have written tests, you don't feel like logging. So this is a good balance that you have then, because you're sure that it's going to run. Now, third point again is do not log large objects. So if you have a big profile or of course, I hope you're not going to log any image, because that's going to put out the binary data over there. But if you have large objects, which let's say request context, or if you have like 50 or 60 fields, don't log out the entire object. Just log parts of it. Okay. So this third point also says log less. Fourth point is saying log more. Okay. Log with context. Don't log large objects, but log with context. Now, context here is not request context. It is what are the things which have happened when this function was called. So, if you're going to call this function with request ID 10 and username 20, so on and so forth, those are things which are context. Right. But if you put in 50 fields, then no one can read that log line. It's useless. Even with a grep command, I have to then start cutting that log. So, and in fact, this is also a very important thing nowadays, because machine learning systems, which are downstream, which actually read your logs and try to find out how the system is running, they find it useful if the log lines are short and concise. Okay. If you have the whole context over there, then point one, it's it takes more time for them to learn. And point two is that they have to, sometimes they find useless correlations. Like the ID of the request means that this is from India, which is actually nonsense, right? It's a random ID. So the problem over there was that you logged the entire request, which was not the right thing to do. Right. So yeah, the 4 points, two of them saying, please log more, and two of them saying, please log less. But actually all of them saying the same thing, which is log as much as you can in with the proper context.
Right. Yeah. I mean, yeah. One question from my side. Okay. So you have a large object and you want to sort of see that if the large object is being sent properly from the back end or something like that, but you can't exactly, because logging that definitely has a pain. Like it's pain. Yeah. So how do you check that, or is there any
So one of the things here, Jay, is that there's quite a few things you can do here. You can log it on the debug level. So during testing, that's one way. But if you want to see what the prod, you know, on prod, you want to see the log line. Here, logging the entire object is not a bad idea. So I should probably add a point over here that whenever you're logging to external systems or logging from external systems, you can log the entire object, no issues. Because that makes a lot of sense, because you need to have some sort of state that you are sure about. Now, if there's a mistake outside, then you won't be able to figure out otherwise. One of the things you can do to kind of debug this situation is to hit that API and try to get that object from the database or from an external system. But that's not a permanent solution, because for a particular request, why did it fail? Then we have context. And I think point number four over here outweighs the point number three, when it is an external system.
Yeah, I mean, if you don't have any control over it, you might as well, you can have a separate file or a separate log. Like you have logs like debug log, info log, and things like that, right? You can have a different log file with just like that information with the time code or the request code or something like that, if it's very huge and you don't want it to clutter the main logs, sort of.
Yeah, you're right. In fact, the debug log can be done on staging and on your local system. The reason I think that logging the entire request is not a bad idea for external systems is because you know, point number one and point number four are saying the same thing. Be pessimistic and log with context. In the case of external systems, really logging the entire request is not a bad idea. But so when the request first enters your system, log the entire thing with this thing. On the other hand, when the request is flowing around inside your system, I don't think logging large objects is a good idea there. So.
Yeah, I mean, as long as you have ran tests on your system and you know that if the structure of the data is right, that's coming in, then there shouldn't be no problem if the tests are written well.
With engineers like me, you know, that's pretty big. But yeah, you're right. So I think that's majorly the points that I wanted to discuss. In case we come up with a question, I have a couple of more points in my head. Okay. But if we meet those questions online right now, it's good. Otherwise, I'll pick them also.
Oh, yeah. So this is Gaurav Singh's YouTube channel. I think it should be visible, right?
Yeah. I think this is just my YouTube channel, guys. If you want to learn about system design, like I said, it is something which is, I don't think, going to be very relevant 10 years down the line. Hopefully, it won't be very relevant. Otherwise, I am in a very slow world. I was born at the wrong time. Because really, if you look back at the kind of interview questions or the kind of things people needed to know earlier, that when you type google.com on your browser, what actually happens? How does your ISP and DNS and routers route the request? And computer engineers needed to know a lot about all this stuff. Now we don't. We're not asked, and we don't need to know. And that's the best thing, right? Similarly, I think system design, I hope that 10 years down the line, this playlist is the most irrelevant thing out there. It's more like a recreational fun kind of thing. Unfortunately, right now, we do need this stuff. We have load balancers, we have message queues, we have microservices, things you have to think about. How do you, you know, make an API and all that? Hopefully, it'll all go. But yeah, Jay, you were saying something about this.
This is all the abstraction, right? We needed to know about how routers work and everything else 10 years before. Because that was something at the level at which you were implementing things or working on things. And right now it's abstract and maybe it might get more abstract from here onwards.
Absolutely, absolutely. There's also a lot of machine learning, like data scientists right now, they need to know a lot about data pipelines. They need to know a lot about how is this data being cleaned and then, you know, cron jobs and stuff like that. Hopefully 10 years down the line, people will be like, yeah. I know I'm a geek. That's why I know. But it's not like I needed to know it. Hopefully we'll have systems which will take care of this. But right now, yeah, for you, you know, to sound cool 10 years later, it would be nice if you go through these playlists. Yeah.
I still know people who are like actually writing in the world where we have Unity and things like these. They're writing low-level C# code to render things, and he's making his own rendering library on JS. And I'm like, there are people who still do these kind of stuff, low-level stuff, because they love it.
Yeah. There's a guy in, I won't tell the company name, but he wrote a full JSON and XML parser, which is a waste of life, actually. It's just for fun, I guess. But he was doing it during company time. Like, he was...
Oh. Okay, then you definitely shouldn't name him.
Yeah, but in large companies, you can get away with a lot of things, you know, like just working on your own side project and calling it the project of the thing that you're doing. But anyway,
yeah. I mean, if it was helpful for his company project, then yeah. No.
Yeah, it wasn't, yeah. But okay, go on, yeah.
Because I know someone who is working at Microsoft, and he is like kind of looking Microsoft Research. He's kind of looking at creating his own template rendering for forums, Google Forms kind of forums, mm-hmm. into Android application, native applications.
Oh,
and
wow.
It's just for fun. He can do it like in a simple manner, but he's like, no, we can create a rendering whole package of Android, and he might. He is that kind of person.
Yeah, crazy people. Good, crazy in a good way, sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good crazy, yeah. But guys, if you have any questions, do let us know in the chat. We are here for the next 5 minutes, I think. This is 55, yeah. This is 5 minutes. What's the time right now? It's 3:49, okay. Yeah, we have some time in case you have any questions. There's just 38 of you, so every question can be answered. That's a good thing.
So what are you up to right now?
What am I doing these days? There's multiple things. Let's take it short term first. There's a University of Texas talk that I have on 2nd, which is I think day after tomorrow, right? After that, yeah.
Oh, wow.
So preparing for that, that's a machine learning and distributed systems. After that, like in terms of colleges, there's like 3 talks planned for March. But the good news is, Interview Ready is also a course that I am working on, and I'm going to get content on it, added to it very soon.
Oh, wow.
The thing has been shot. It is edited. Now I need to post. I mean, I need to like make the questions and all that, but it's coming. Apart from that, what else? Yeah, mainly I've been focusing on Interview Ready for a while. There was a time when on the YouTube channel I was making garbage collection videos. That brings some collaborations also there.
Oh, wow.
I really don't know how I'm going to save my time, really. Thank God for my wife, you know, she's the one who's keeping me sane. Otherwise, I would have like lost it by now. I would have been talking half the day. Why isn't this happening? What the hell is going on these days? I'm pretty brutal with myself, actually. Like, Gaurav, what are you doing?
Yeah, I'm just doing an internship, and I hardly get time to work on my personal projects. And yeah, I'm trying to get to do some sort of like talks on my own. Maybe get some talks out. Yeah.
Okay. That's interesting. But yeah, college is also pretty tough. You know, you have the entire day in which you have to study. Then you have a project from college very often.
Yeah.
Or you pick up something of yourself.
I think we have some questions. Yeah.
Sure. What motivated you to document what you? I'm sorry, Jen. Go on. Yeah. I just wanted to go one up on you. Yeah.
No. Yeah. Sure. Go ahead. Answer it if you want.
No. Why don't you read it to me? It makes me.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So the question is. What motivated you to document your journey and publish it on YouTube? Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think I've always been interested in posting about interesting algorithms and solutions. So I used to do it in CodeChef also. Now I don't know what's happened to the site, but okay.
That's a different talk. Yeah.
Okay. So I there used to be discussion forums when I used to post my solution to a problem. Thank God. So, you know, over there, when people used to like the thing and be like, wow, this is really useful to us, I used to feel nice. So I think this YouTube thing was just a video form of the same thing. And that's how I started off, just documenting what I've learned and publishing it on YouTube. Another thing was, honestly, I didn't find many good video editorials during my time.
Oh, okay.
Not many. There was Tushar Roy. He made some good video interviews. But apart from that, I didn't find anything around computer programming to the level that I was expecting. So I thought, okay, let me do it then. So easy.
Wow, that's it. Even I was trying to document my internship process, because when I was in my first or second year, I was very interested in what actually people do in jobs. Like, what do they write tests? Do they write API? What sort of, do they have meetings? How many meetings? PS a lot.
Of course. No, it's a double-edged sword, a meeting, because you're investing a lot of time, and if you don't derive that value, then it's a waste. But many times meetings are also very important. Honestly, like for interns, maybe not so much, but as a person who works, right, sometimes you get irritated, but sometimes it's very important.
Yeah, I mean, at times I just don't want to attend meetings, and at times I was like, are you free? I just want to have 5-minute talk. I have some doubts. Are you free? And the other person is busy on 2-hour long meetings and stuff like that. So Ash asks, tell us something about your college journey. Like, how were those 4 years?
My first year, first semester, I failed in this exam. It was called Basic Electronics. So BEEE, we used to call it Basic Electronics and Electrical Engineering, I think. So that had like simple things like you had a circuit, Norton's rule, and Kirchhoff's law.
Memories.
I think I scored 15 out of 100. And so for giving the paper for review, you need at least 30.
Okay.
Couldn't even clear that, like 15, nowhere near. And the next time I gave the exam, I was pretty confident I passed. I got a 40 out of 100. So, I wasn't that confident. Like, but so first year, that's a strange thing. I think in first year, when I went to my dad and said that, you know, I failed this exam, it was the first time when he said that just one. He didn't mean it in a sarcastic way. He actually meant that he was surprised. He was happy. I think what happened is I realized then that he's expecting things of me. Now he's expecting that this guy's an adult. He's going to handle things himself. And I kind of took that to heart. So I studied well and I cleared the exam next semester. But then I realized that, you know what, if I'm going to be called a computer engineer, then I need to live up to that reputation. So honestly, like, enough. Let's be a real guy for once. So I started coding a lot. I started coding the traveling salesman problem. It took me 6 months to complete, you know, the dynamic programming part of it.
Yeah.
But in second year, that was a big achievement for me. In second year, I also started coding in my practicals, like the fastest. There was a Boots algorithm on multiplication. I still remember in my batch, I was the fastest. So these things are not going to be quantified. No one is going to come and give a certificate or a badge that fastest in the lab. But it makes a big difference. Eventually, I realized it made a huge difference. There were a lot of people who didn't know what they are doing, while I, on the other hand, knew how computer systems to some extent work, like a lot better than the average graduate. So it was good. That has been my journey. In fourth year, a lot of people recognized me. A lot of people, in the sense, I talk like a YouTuber these days. A lot of people, meaning the teachers in my college, they knew me because I had secured the highest placement that our college used to get, which is Morgan Stanley. So they were like, okay, this is Gaurav. He probably knows what he's talking about. This is Gaurav, that jumped up guy who talks a lot. But then it came to this. And I think it's a good thing that I you know, overall, I'm very pleased with my college journey, actually.
Yeah, I mean, that's great if you're pleased with the journey, because I'm not, because I got to spend the last year of my college from home. So say what you want.
Oh, yeah. That's tough, man. That's like, I hope you guys have a good reunion or something. But
hopefully, when we get our graduate degree.
Hopefully, if you get your graduate degree, or is it?
I think it might happen in June or August. Yeah.
Okay. Might is a very good thing.
Ayush asks, which is tougher, CP or system design?
Okay, Ayush, you type that on Google, you'll get an answer.
I mean, it's a subjective thing. Is actually system design harder than CP? Like,
I personally, like, CP, system design, it's like, what is tougher, English or French? Or actually, even further away, I would say mechanics or linguistics. It has no, it has little relation. And tougher is what? I'll try to put as an engineer. Yeah. They're different subject, man. There's no way you can compare. Okay. Use on Rust language. I haven't coded in Rust. System design, cause you don't know the green tick marks always. That's a big dialogue, Abhik. Okay, cool, yeah. You're talking about big dialogues nowadays, huh?
Abhik is like the Rust fanboy, I think.
Interesting. Avik also is asking, do you think people now try to make everything a microservice more than necessary, like separate things which are not logically separate, just to fit neat and nice design? Well, have a look at Uber's history in microservices. They built something called nanoservices, not on purpose, but what used to happen is any kind of module which can be isolated used to be isolated, used to make a service. And then we learned the hard way, like, I'm no longer in Uber, but the engineers over there learned the hard way that this is not going to work. Interactions is difficult. Discovering services for engineers is difficult, how much ever you try to document them. So yeah, you're right. People do sometimes think, but there's the problem on both extremes. Some people are like, no, we are going to stay with the monolith forever. Some people are like, no, we are going to make a microservice out of everything. And you have to be somewhere in between, probably.
I'm not sure, but I think Spotify has like a million. I think it shouldn't be a million, but a lot of microservices.
Yeah, Yeah, I know some companies have a lot of microservices, like thousands. And Spotify, well, if it's a million, I'll be surprised, but I won't be like, I won't bet my life on no, that is not possible. It is. A million is possible. Maybe what they've done is really, really...
Just for context, don't quote me on that.
You just said that Spotify has a million microservices. Okay. With Jay from IIIT.
Everyone is going on Twitter and like just bashing on me.
Okay.
I think, is there anything else? Yeah.
I think we are at the hour mark. I think most questions have been answered. Thank you all for tuning in. It's been a pleasure talking about system design in a practical way. And thank you, Jay, for also tuning in. It's been a pleasure to host you in this conference.
Yeah, it has been a pleasure to be the host. P.S. I just got to know that I was the host 20 minutes before. If you think I wasn't prepared, that is why.
No, I'm just kidding. Or am I kidding? No, but Jay, one minute. There's Varad, Abhik, all of you guys, thank you so much. Sham also, who made this possible, I'd say. Along with Kuldeep Pizda, who I don't know, but I'm sure is part of your organization.
Kuldeep, do you want to...
Kuldeep is our next guest here.
Kuldeep Pizda is just a student, guys. Just a student is how you describe him. But okay, see ya, guys. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Goro.
Is the live stream over or is it still on? I think it's still on.
Yes, thank you for the introduction. Yeah, so I don't have any specific topic. If like, you know, I would say I would talk about only simple general things that you should focus, that you should remember while participating in any hackathon or any competition. So I will talk mainly about that. So apart from it, if the participants have any questions, then I think I would like to address them first.
Yes, I will just speak one. So, sir, what do you think is the most important thing that one needs to focus while he's participating in a hackathon? So, what things that he should focus his resources on in a limited period?
Okay. So, one of the basic things that you should mainly focus is the whole purpose of participating in a hackathon should be learning, apart from the prizes, obviously. So, like, you know, hackathons are the, that period of time, like, you know, when where we learn, like a lot of things. For example, we have a time constraint and we have to make something work in the given time constraint. So it is actually like one of the best period to learn anything. So if you, like, you know, focus solely based on learning, then I think it will be the best period for you. Because this is how, like, we learn a lot of things. Just give me some second, like, let me switch on the video. Is possible? So that has been my not my voice is not echoing, right?
No, sir, it's fine.
Okay, yeah. So one thing that I would say is your focus should be solely based on learning, not on the otherwise things, right? Like if you, for example, if you focus on, like, you know, winning prizes and stuff, then it's not gonna work, to be honest. Let me tell you. For example, if I share my experience, we participated in our first hackathon at Airtel headquarters, Gurgaon. So, like, you know, it was our first hackathon right after the first year of our college, and, like, you know, we did not know a lot of things at by then because we had just started. So what we did was, like, you know, we tried to implement a lot of things that we did not know. And that was one, because first of all, we did not have any experience. No one was there to guide us. Like, you know, that you have participating in a hackathon, just focus on these things and all, blah, blah, blah. So we just went random and, like, you know, we were trying everything that we could. So, for example, in a hackathon, like, you know, you see your fellow teammates as well. So what usually happens is, like, you know, we try to copy them. For example, if you hear someone's idea, like, you know, it basically gives us, like, you know, it says that, like, you know, it initiates the thought in mind that I can also include this feature in our application. And yes, once you start thinking like that, then it starts to become, like, you know, a big mess. So I would simply say, like, you know, work on your idea for some time. For example, whenever we used to participate, my teammates, what we used to do was, like, you know, if the hackathon is, no matter if the hackathon is, like, you know, 24 hour long or 36 hour long, we used to solely devote our time, like, you know, the first 1 or 2 hours, we used to solely devote our time on, like, you know, what we are gonna do. Like, you know, what problem we are gonna solve, how we are gonna solve it, and what kind of technology stacks and all other things. So basically, we used to plan the, like, you know, in the initial hours, and once we had planned, like, you know, you basically get a roadmap of what you want to do. So once you have that clarity, then, like, you know, we freeze that, like, you know, then we freeze things that these are some set of features that we want to include, and then we start inculcating all other, like, you know, the features that we had decided earlier. So that way you can become, like, you know, more consistent. The other thing that I would say is, like, you know, if the hackathon is not started, probably try several things that you want to try. For example, if you want to use Django in your hackathon, so my suggestion would be to, like, you know, at least have some basic hands-on on Django. Like, let's say make some CRUD application, be it if you're using Node or Express, just try to use that before the hackathon. So that, like, you know, if things, for example, errors are obviously gonna come, no matter what you do, no matter how much precaution you take. If you're coding, the bug will come, or, like, you know, errors will obviously come. So your ideology should be, like, you know, you should at least know about what is happening. For example, if you're not able to understand the error, then, like, you know, it will be total, like, you know, you'll focus solely on solving the bug. For example, you want to make an API, and, like, you know, your whole time will be spent on fixing a simple bug. It may be a typo, or it may be, like, you know, simple misconfiguration of some software and stuff. So if you want to avoid that, probably, like, you know, get started with the technology that you want to use. That will be a plus one for, that will be a plus, and it will obviously give you an edge. And if you have been participating in hackathon, then obviously you know all those drills, like, you know, that these are the technology tools that I want to use, and on blah, blah, blah things. Everything. So I would say, first of all, focus on learning. Your end goal should be to learn, like, you know, not to earn, okay? A learn comes first, and then you remove that, as they say. So, yeah, solely focus on the hackathon should be solely for learning things. And also, it is a, like, you know, kind of playground for trying new tools as well. So, for example, like, you know, a lot of things that actually we tried at, like, you know, we tried to build some as a sort of products. We actually tried them in hackathons. So also hackathons, like, you know, some kind of, it acts as a playground for you to test your ideas, to test your hypothesis, and the judges and the participants also give like, you know, their valuable feedback. So from that perspective also, it is a place to learn. So yeah, okay, I'll say.
Sir, do you think that
your voice is not audible?
Hello sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Yes. So sir, do you think that we should try out new things in hackathon or focus on things that we already know? Okay, so many of us like wanted to try new, there is some technique, for example. So you like to try it on, but hackathon way there's a limited time. So do you think that we should focus on things we know or we should try out new things?
So I will say take like calculated risk. Like, you know, if you are thinking that you will go and indirectly you will pick some technology and then you will get started, then probably it's not going to happen, because like, you know, there are some, if you, for example, like, you know, if you want to use, let's say, Docker, you have not worked with Docker at all and you're directly using it in the hackathon, so there's a good chance that, like, you know, you might get stuck and you'll get totally stuck in that. It will eat up all your time of the hackathon, and then it will demotivate you that you're not able to do anything at all, something like that. So definitely it should be calculated risk. You should try new tools because it is a wonderful place to try. You don't have a large time to commit for that specific thing. But yeah, it should be calculated risk. It should not be like, you know, you just Google something, some tools come up and then you start using it like that. So
So sir, you also like help data science, data enthusiasts and all.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think that we should use deep learning or machine learning methods is enough? Because many of us like to use deep learning just for the hype. Okay, so most of these data enthusiasts or technologists, they just say that old machine learning methods are like enough most of the time, but we just use deep learning. So do you think we should use, and what are the effects of it? Sir, mute ho gaya sir. Your voice is muted.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes.
So I will say that, like, you know, as I said earlier, that, like, you know, take a calculated risk. So if you're confident enough that you can use deep learning in your project, then definitely use it. If you, like, you say new to it, then probably, like, you know, don't use it. Use something that you're confident. For example, and also it depends on, like, you know, how much the deep learning contributes your whole project. For example, if the deep learning is the core of your project, then I would say that you should have some knowledge, some introduction about deep learning. If you don't have that, then probably try something else. It should not be the core. Like, you know, what you're experimenting with, that technology or tool should not be the core of your project. You should have, like, you know, at least some hands-on for that. But the thing is, like, you know, there are a lot of beginners who have just started, and probably they don't have, like, you know, that much experience and stuff. And this is their first time participating in a hackathon or exploring tools as well. So from that perspective also, like, it is okay, like, you know, for you guys, like, you just started, like, you know. So first of all, congratulations that you took to, like, you know, learn things, so you took initiative to participate in hackathons and try out things. So yeah, kudos for them. So for example, for the whole segment of, like, you know, the beginners, it is kind of like the birth for them. They can try anything they want. Because usually the first hackathon is just to, like, you know, to familiarize yourself with the hackathon, to the buzzword, what is hackathon, what you actually do and stuff. So I would say first one to hackathon should be to, like, you know, to actually get the mentality of, like, you know, what hackathon should be and what you should expect from a hackathon kind of thing. But if you are, like, you know, if you have participated in, like, let's say several hackathons, then I would say that probably try to follow some approach, like, you know, on how you can win the hackathon, or at the same time you're learning. So that is one thing that I would say.
Okay, sir. Yeah, that's great. Mm-hmm. Another question, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, so we have this kind of time crush in hackathon, the limited time. So what things that we should focus most? Matlab, we should focus more on planning. Should we focus more on teamwork? Should we focus more on coding? How do you manage it?
What we used to do was, like, you know, for example, when we were making teams, at the time also only we had, like, you know, decided roles. For example, if we are a team of three, then, like, you know, in college, we are pro specifically in the web development. So what we used to do is, like, you know, we used to have a front end expert, we used to have a back end expert, and then we used to have a full stack expert. So, for example, like, you know, if we used to, like, you know, plan things out that this is something that we want to come up with, then as I initially I said that, like, you know, we used to plan things for at least 1 or 2 hours, so that, like, how we can proceed, what how we're exactly gonna solve the problems, and at the same time also we were thinking of, like, you know, what question judges may ask seeing this solution, because hackathon is like we are building some solution for some problem, right? It's not about, like, making a website, making a web application and stuff. So from that perspective, we used to do the meetings and stuff, and we used to figure out things that this is exactly what we are trying to solve. This is how exactly we are gonna solve, and then since we already have a, like, decided role in the team, then we used to distribute work that hey, Ramesh is good in content. So these are the let's discuss the mockup as well right now. And once we have decided, like, you know, locking to the mockups, we like the front end guy will make the mockups, the back end guy will make the, like, you know, the APIs and stuff, and this full stack developer, his primary job is to, like, you know, integrate front end and back end. And at the same time, we used to, for example, if it is a 24-hour hackathon, right? Then we used to spend, like, 1 to 2 hours in planning and strategizing things, and at the same time, last 2 hours at least in, like, in making presentations and trying to find answers for the probable question that any judge may ask to us. So this is how we used to divide things and stuff. So this is how probably you can do this. The thing is, if you're making a team, the role of a specific person should be specified. It should not be, like, you know, after the hackathon starts, you are like, Ramesh is also working on the front end, and Mukesh is also working on the front end, right? And no one is working on the back end. So it should not be like that, because we are a team. So if all the wheels of the vehicle moves in the same direction, then the vehicle will move forward, like, you know, correctly. So that is very, very important thing. So initially, before starting work, let's just sit together, try to brainstorm the solution that you are working on, try to brainstorm, like, you know, think like a judge, just you, place yourself in place of judge, just put yourself in the shoes of judge, and, like, you know, try to ask some general question that any judge may ask. So it gives clarity to all the team members. For example, like, you know, what happens is if you are working on a problem, if you are working on a solution, then usually the solution is of probably 1 or 2%. Like, if it is a team of 5 members, then usually 2% take lead, and, like, you know, their solution actually gets approved by the team. So in this brainstorming solution, actually it helps to clear doubts of all the team members, and at the same time they also get on the same page, this is exactly what we are going to do, this is exactly how we are going to do it, and likewise. So this will be my suggestion, that first take time, enough time, I won't say for example for and this 1 or 2 hour that we are that I'm telling you is not a, like, you know, not a hard rule written on a book, something like that. It was something, it is based on, like, you know, it was based solely on the teammates that we had. So we had been participating for, like, you know, for like last couple of hours, and then we know that we need to spend, like, you know, at least 1 hour, 2 hours to, like, get things straight, and then we'll start working on, and then this is just about coding and stuff. So figure that out for yourself. So I won't say that you take 1 hour, 2 hour things. For you, it may be 3 or 4 hours. For someone, it may be, like, even 15 minutes meeting is enough as well. So I would say just take enough time, if I'm saying enough time, that means that all the team members are actually on the same page. If anyone, like, you know, if any judge comes and picks any random member from the team, he should be able to explain the whole concept of your solution to the judge. So it should be like enough that much spending that much enough time with in these things and then get started with coding and so on. And at the same time, like, you know, as you see, for example, if you don't have that much good presentation, no matter how much good solution, no matter how much great solution you have made, come up with, if you're not able to explain it to just, then it is of no use. So you should also spend enough time on, like, you know, showcasing it to just, on beautifying things as well. So yeah, this is what I would say.
You should focus on all departments of that.
Yeah, you should focus, definitely focus on all things, all because all things are important. Like, I would say, like, you know, this hackathon, for this hackathon, consider yourself as, like, you know, you are an entrepreneur and this is your startup idea. You're working on some solution and think like you're pitching to, like, you know, some judges. They will reward you, like, you know, for your startup idea. And if it works good, then they will, like, you know, award to you some kind. Why this ideology? Because, like, you know, we are doing the same thing only. For example, like, you know, we are brainstorming with the problem that we are working with. We are brainstorming, like, you know, we are coming up with the most optimal solution that may be there to solve that problem. Then we are actually making it happen, like, you know, from concept to making it POC, proof of concept, application, verification, Android application, or anything that basically demonstrates that this problem is being solved by this thing, by our solution. And at the same time, the last important thing will be to is how you present it to the judges or the customers, likewise. So I would say focus on, like, you know, these things, because these things are actually well important enough. So yeah.
Yes, that's great, sir. Most of the people starting out in hackathons, like, so we are in this hackathon, those who are participating are mostly first time people from our college. So unke liye, what do you think is the best advice you can give to them? They are starting out for the first time. So what things they should
I would say if you're can you repeat it again?
What precautions should they take, sir, for the first hackathon? What should they not do?
Okay. So I don't think, like, you know, for them, like, I should try to specify, like, some do or some do not, kind of thing. I would simply say that, like, you know, focus on learning, first hackathon, take out time, like, you know, familiarize yourself with the hackathon, this hackathon word, what is hackathon, the process of this hackathon, and, like, you know, just focus on learning, because this is not the last hackathon that you're participating in. So I would say that explore as much as you can, talk with people as much as you can, and at the same time, like, you know, usually in hackathons we have a community platform where all the team members are there, right? I think probably you two might have Slack community or anything at place where all can communicate together. So take it as a, like, you know, as a platform to, like, you know, to learn things. For example, if you encounter someone who knows better than you, then probably try to talk with him, try to network with that person, like, you know, that how he started, how he's doing, and how you can learn from his experience. So I would say that focus solely on learning. And if you talk about do's and don'ts, then I will say that since this is your first hackathon, I won't specify any do's and don'ts. I would say that, like, you know, take out something simple. Don't get into, like, you know, like, some complex things. For example, if you're from first year, then I would say that don't jump directly into, like, you know, the machine learning problems and stuff, because that will demotivate you at the end, because you have not worked, you don't know the domain of that specific topic, specific technology or tool. So probably get started with, like, you know, simple things. Let's say if you're coming up with a solution, then probably make a web application or make an Android application, because those are comparatively easier. And at the same time, like, you know, you can see the progress of your work. For example, if you take the data science problem, then what we do is, like, you know, we make a Python script or, like, you know, or R script or something like that. And the thing is, like, no one is able to see the progress of that thing. So internally, it will demotivate you that, like, you know, in 24 hours I could not make anything, and, like, you know, I totally wasted my time, I'm not capable enough, and blah 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 blah. So if you, like, you know, if you just want to take things progressively, then I would say start with simple things, like, probably make a simple web application, a simple website, it can also be simple Android application because those are completely easier. At the same time, we can see the exact progress that this form is able to, now we are able to see this form, now we are able to see this many fields in the form, now we are able to see a button, submit button, now we are able to submit that button kind of thing. So for beginners, I will say start gently, don't be harsh on yourself, and at the same time, this is not your last hackathon. So give yourself enough space so that you can explore things and prepare yourself for the next hackathon that you participate in the coming years, the college life and stuff. So yeah.
Sir, till now we have talked a lot about hackathon also. For a change, could you tell us a little bit about the startup Happy Chases, sir?
Okay, so Happy Chases was a digital publication company. We used to have a magazine application. So actually, we are a digital company, and we produce digital content that promotes productivity, mental health and all those things. All those things basically will help you grow. So this is what we were doing last year, and we could not make profit from it, so I had to shut it down. So yeah, that was about Happy Chases. So it is, and at the time it is kind of a community where you can share your learning. Because I believe that everyone is here of their own life. Everyone's life is a different movie altogether, right? If you start comparing things, then it won't be helpful because your story is different, his story is different. And you are the hero of your life. He is the hero of his own life. He is the hero of her own life. So basically, I wanted to promote this thing. At the same time, I also wanted to inculcate such things, for example, productivity, how you can be more productive and less distracted, for example, in the digital world. Okay, it is very, very easy to get distracted from the things that are available in the internet. Netflix and chill, it is a very good example for that. So it is good. I'm not saying that it is bad, but excess of everything is bad. So how you can manage those things at the same time, for example, we are youths, probably in early 20s or early 30s or something like that. So this Indian education system actually does not teach us about various things, and one of the common thing is the financial management. So we should focus on that aspect as well, how you can probably focus on your start focusing on your finance from your college life, and start inculcating habit of saving or investing in stock market or anything, some sort of like that. So we used to produce magazines based on that, and we had two issues for that, but we are on a hold. This pandemic affected us as well. We are actually rethinking on what we can do, how we can start working on our progress as well. This was a lot of happy series. If we talk about Code Vector, that basically I'm currently actively working on the other company. So basically, we are a data science company. We offer data science solutions, artificial intelligence solutions to startups, enterprises, and governments. So yeah, we basically talk with them, and based on their requirement, we actually tailor made some solution that involves data science specifically. We specialize specifically in computer vision and all the situations related that revolves around this computer vision domain. So we usually that is our sweet spot, and we make products and stuff. So for example, recently one of our government project we are working with the Tamil Nadu government to make basically what we have done is we have made an application that basically detects cataracts in the eye, and it is a very utility tool for them. For example, they have a government project where they wanted to identify people who have cataract, and they wanted to treat them. But because there is not single platform or single tool where any single person, any normal person can screen the patient. So because screening actually requires specification, right? If you're not a doctor, you may not be able to identify that this person has cataract or not, something like that. So basically, we replace that with our AI model, and we inculcated that in our application. and the health workers there, they are actually using it. They are, what they have to do is they just take the picture of the patient, and a model tells that this person is like, you know, this person has cataract, and this person does not have cataract, and like that. So this is one of the recent policies that we had delivered for the central Tamil Nadu government. Apart from it, we have worked with like, you know, several clients from abroad, from across the globe. And we usually work on computer vision. So what happened was, like, you know, since we're a data science company, we used to hire candidates for data science positions in our company. And at the time, we actually realized that the participants who are coming up with the, like, you know, with an intent to do internship with us, they had done, like, you know, some good courses, some certification courses from, like, you know, some renowned platforms like Udacity or Udemy or Coursera and like that. But their knowledge was, like, you know, specifically limited to that specific course only. For example, if a person has done, like, you know, an course on autonomous car driving, right? So that person only, for example, this project basically uses computer vision heavily, right? To identify the roads, to identify the track, whether it is turning, if it is turning left, it is turning right, and identifying single, okay, that is the red signal, we have to stop, this green signal, we can move forward, and like that. So the thing was, the ideal expectation, like, you know, as employer, our expectation is, like, you know, since they have worked on computer vision, they should be able to, do more work in computer vision. I'm saying computer vision. I'm not saying that you have to find path and stuff. Rather, I'm saying that you have to detect helmet from, let's say, given CCTV footage of a highway, right? So the actual trouble starts right here from them, they were able to identify, the path from the given road, but they were not able to identify the helmet from the given highway footage, like that. So it was one of the, like, you know, major gap that we realized, and it was not with a single candidate. Almost most of the candidates that we had, that we worked for, like, you know, last couple of years, realized that this is one of the major gaps, and that's why we actually, like, you know, jumped from this offering services to teaching AI and stuff. So what we did was, we are focusing on creating a, like, you know, community of data science enthusiasts. It includes the students or any enthusiasts who want to learn data science, to the data science professionals who are, like, you know, working on some big companies, or some of them are professors, or some of us are, like, you know, startup people, like that. So basically, we want to, like, you know, teach people AI that could be affordable, first of all, because, like, you know, people can learn it, but the main hurdle that comes in is, like, you know, the courses are not affordable. For example, if you go to one of the popular courses of Tripathi Hyderabad, it costs, like, you know, 2 lakhs and stuff, something like this, for one of the basic courses, but it costs like that. The thing is, the content is not the issue. Like, everyone has the same content, right? The Tripathi guide, the Tripathi Hyderabad guide 2 has the same content, V2 have the same content, the Coursera 2 has the same content. The thing that actually, like, you know, differentiates everyone is the experience, or, like, you know, the way of teaching things. So what we did was, since the content is available, we did not want to charge for, like, you know, any of that thing. So that's why what we did was, we have introduced a, like, you know, course that is known as AI Champ. So it is, like, very affordable course, we are offering it for, like, you know, like 3,500 kind of in that price. And the content is same. The content is highly standard. You can compare it with any popular courses. It is, like, almost similar. The real deal, what we are trying to do is, like, since we have, as I said, that we are a data science company, we have worked with the clients from across the globe, like, you know, be it startup, be it enterprise, and be it government. So what we're doing is, we are trying to focus on, like, you know, case study based learning. So, like, you know, in IIMs, what happens is, like, you know, they don't teach theory, rather they teach based on the case studies. And we have a lot of case studies in our data science company. What we are doing is, we are taking the theory part. We have the case study that obviously we have deployed in the real time. We, like, you know, connect those things, and based on that connection, we tell the participant or teacher, the candidate, that, like, you know, this is how this works, and, like, you know, this is the implication of that, this application of this specific thing. If you do this, then it will like this, like that. So basically, the focus is on, like, you know, making that person, making that person teach how to learn, not rather on, like, you know, specific teaching what is the education and stuff, rather teaching it in a that way, so that, for example, if anything comes up, he could be able to solve it itself. the one of the major thing that we realize is like, you know, people are not able to debug, and it is one of the very like, you know, very common problem that we see, that we realize that the candidates have. So like, you know, and making them understanding, making them understand the error, like if the error has come, then how you can break it down, how you can understand that error, and how you can solve it, rather than like, you know, the at least copy pasting question and posting in communities and stuff, right? Because it becomes spam kind of thing. Most of the time it happens with us as well. Like, you know, in the error, it is clearly mentioned that this is the error, but still they are like, you know, they're not reading the line, rather they're asking what is wrong, what is wrong, what is wrong, like that. So in this in that course, basically we want to inculcate all those things that we think that are lacking on the courses that are out there, and at the same time making, like, you know, making AI education affordable. So yeah, that's why you might see in my LinkedIn head that, like, you know, on a mission to help 10 million individuals learn AI, and that's what we are doing. You can check out our, like, you know, AHM by CV Labs YouTube channel. We have started putting out contents, like, you know, we have started putting on contents in, like, in simpler words, for a short period of time. For example, if you want to learn about the basic syntaxes of NumPy, so we have tried to explain in, like, you know, most simplest manner that we can, like, you know, not using any jargons and stuff, rather explaining it in a way that way anyone can understand it. So yeah, this is what we are focusing on right now, like, you know, making people understand AI, and that way they can solve more AI problems, more than what we could do as a company. So yeah, this is our mission as of now, new mission as of now.
Audience will also go and check out the channel for sure.
Okay, yeah, sure, definitely.
I think you're out of time, sir. It's been great talking to you, sir. You have given us some great insights.
Mm-hmm.
It's been great talking to you, another sir.
Sure, sure.
Thank you.
Sure, guys. So all the best, guys, for the hackathon. And yeah, I am hoping to see, like, you know, a lot of great inventions. And like, do not fear that you are not able to, like, you know, make good things. For example, if you want to, like, you know, reach to the top floor, then stepping on the first step is also very important. So, like, you know, not today, but maybe tomorrow it will be your day. So keeping that in mind, like, you know, start preparing for the hackathon, make something awesome. Yeah, hoping to talk to you with all the participants in a good manner. Yeah, all the best, guys. Okay. So, hello, is the call?